Hi all, welcome to our next video. In this one, we're going to explore the idea of the real number line as the embodiment of continuity. And one. In this video, we're going to explore the real number line as the embodiment of continuity. And we'll be able to use this construction to obtain continuous mappings between lines and line segments. We'll be able to parameterize lines and plane curves by sets of real numbers, t an element of the real numbers, and if you want to, you can parameterize such lines and curves by sets of numbers of limited extent, say between minus 1 and plus 1. We'll be able to establish real valued functions of real numbers and the continuity of sections, at least of some of them. Let's take a look at this. First of all, the real number line was established with some degree of rigor, I would say. The important work of Dedekind and others, where a one-to-one correspondence was established between the real numbers and the Euclidean geometric points on a line. So Euclid defined what a geometric line is and what points on it are in a abstract postulational formulation. Dedekind was motivated by his experience in trying to explain and teach calculus, where drawing lines and moving around on them was sort of a crutch to help students understand continuity. And he felt that there should be an abstract formulation of the real numbers where you could simulate anything you could do in Euclidean geometry by stuff going on in arithmetic. And to do that, he had to include not only the rational numbers on the real line, but also all of the irrationals to obtain a full one-to-one correspondence between the numbers and Euclidean geometry. We talked about that a little bit before. So there's more to it than that, though. The real numbers and the geometric lines are similar in other ways. They're totally ordered sets with ordering like this. For the real numbers, if A and B are in R, and if they're distinct numbers, then either A is less than B or A is greater than B, and this goes for all A and B in R. So this is a total ordering of all the real numbers. This is a very powerful property of the real numbers. What about points on a line? If you have two points, A and B, on the line L, the points on the line L obey an ordering just as well. The point A lies to the left of B, or A lies to the right of B, if A and B are distinct points on the line. And this goes for all points A and B on the line. So again, the real numbers and the postulational picture of Euclid match up in this profound way. This ought to be useful. Further, there's a very interesting thing in Euclidean geometry. It actually contains the concept, let's say a concept of continuity. And normally we see continuity in introductory calculus with epsilon and delta, and it's involved in, say, real valued functions of real variables and their various formulations of how you can identify a continuous function at a point and on an interval. In Euclidean geometry, it's different. The process of drawing a line passing through two points, A and B, two distinct points in the plane, contains the idea of continuity. You're starting at one point and moving in a continuous linear fashion along the line to the other point, B. Look at how this is formulated. In Book 1 of the Elements by Euclid, this is part of the treatment of plane geometry, Postulate 1, Book 1, a straight line can be drawn from A to B. Now notice he says drawn from A to B, not exists between A and B. So this process of drawing deserves some thought. We can observe that the process of drawing identifies points on the plane as members of the line, and furthermore, the points are constructed in an orderly, continuous fashion as elements of the line segment AB. So this drawing process is, it's not really necessarily creating points, but it is taking points in the plane and identifying them. So here are a couple of points, and if you start at A, postulate 1 says that you can do this. Sort of a continuity of the trajectory. If you want to do physics, it was like the trajectory of one of these points moving along a line between A and B. This contains a hint, and really probably more than a hint, as we'll see, about how continuity is embodied by this type of construction here. Now, this is sort of a departure. I haven't really followed any literature on this. There may be people who've done this. I'm sure there are. I don't really know of any references. I think it actually works out okay. And we'll see how that develops and see if it's possible to transfer this concept of Euclidean continuity to mappings between lines and geometric objects, and the number line concept, extend that concept of continuity to parameterization of lines and curves, and establishing continuous real-valued functions of real variables, and see if this concept transfers totally over to the real numbers and allows us to have a kind of a geometric foundation for continuity of real-valued functions. Might be interesting. Okay, so let's take a picture here. Draw in the real number line. Here you go. Here it is, a big old number line over here. We're going to call this line L. All right, so this is doing something interesting. We can view this as a mapping. The real number line is a mapping F from the points of L to the real numbers. Function F in the context, you know, if we think about this in the context of manifolds, and we don't have this as a manifold yet, but it's pretty easy to establish that this is a one-dimensional Riemann manifold. This function f, the coordinate function, so every point on the line over here, here's a point p, there is a number xp that is the coordinate of the point p. And so we say xp is equal to f of p. So it takes geometric objects and converts them into real numbers. Since the line itself is a continuous geometric object, it follows that this function f is a continuous function. We're exploring this idea, and I guess you could say this is totally obvious. The line L is a continuous geometric entity, and the real numbers is a continuum of numbers, and the points on the line and the real numbers have the cardinality of the uncountable infinity. So if you say, you can call it a postulate, like the continuum, I think it's called the continuum postulate. If you say that the line is a continuum of points and fills in all the gaps and there's nothing missing from it, then this f that maps points on the line to R is a continuous function mapping one continuum to another in orderly fashion so that neighborhoods are preserved and so on. Now, I mentioned the idea of establishing this real number line as a manifold. So the way you can go about that is to construct a topology of epsilon neighborhoods on the real numbers, and then the correspondence that this neighborhood of size epsilon around the number xp corresponds to a neighborhood of the point p on the line. So this np over here, these are geometric points, but the correspondence between them established by f allows you to play with these points as if they are numerical neighborhoods, epsilon neighborhoods. So this will allow you to establish the standard topology on the real numbers and the corresponding topology on the geometric points of the line. And I won't go into that too much here. Probably everybody knows this. But without even worrying about this stuff, I believe that the Euclidean concept of continuity, as described in the first postulate about how you create a line segment by the process of drawing, and that is a continuous process, it maps over to the real numbers, and so you can, the process of drawing a set of real numbers is a continuous process where you're picking, identifying members of the real numbers in an orderly, continuous fashion, because R is a continuum in the same sense, since R is a continuum in the same sense that the points on the line A to B compose a continuum. A lot of thought went into improving the Euclidean formulation. David Hilbert spent some time on this and has a number of kind of more advanced properties, some axioms and so on. I won't go into those too much. We're going to move along with some construction work here. And so what I'd like to do here, oh, let me say a few words about Euclid himself. Euclid was a real person, a real mathematician, who lived in Alexandria, Egypt, from around 325 BC to 265 BC. Alexandria was established as the capital of Egypt by conquest. Alexander the Great shortly conquered Egypt and established reign of the Ptolemies, you know, installed a king of Egypt, set up Alexandria as the capital city of Egypt. Euclid actually lived during the time of the very first Macedonian Greek, you know, Alexandrian Empire, king of Egypt, Ptolemy the First. I guess it's pronounced Ptolemy. Alexandria became a academic capital of the ancient world. They had the great library of Alexandria, which began around the time of Euclid, or shortly thereafter, grew over hundreds and hundreds of years, was eventually totally destroyed by very catastrophic invasions and so on that happened in later centuries, maybe even 1,000 years after it was founded, something like that. Euclid was, to place Euclid along the timeline of mathematics and philosophy, Plato and the mathematician Eudoxus, the Greek mathematician and Greek philosopher, they lived before Euclid. And Euclid lived before Archimedes. I believe there are historic documents where Archimedes references work from Euclid's Elements, and it's amazing that the entire 13 books of Euclid's Elements was reconstructed through painstaking centuries of research from fragments and students' notes who were, I don't think there was actually ever a copy of the Elements, the original book of Elements found. There were copies that of sections and so on. People working through the examples and various manuscripts came to light. The 13 books include plane geometry, geometric figures, solid geometry, and they're extensive. They're available in paperback through Dover Books, the famous translation, sort of definitive version, as far as I know, is called The 13 Books of Euclid's Elements by Thomas L. Heath, published by Dover Books, New York, in 1925. The one I have, actually I have a copy of the three-volume set, and it's the second edition publication date, 1925. So all of the really serious academic scholars of the ancient world piled onto this problem, and it's probably the most thoroughly written about and researched book ever written, except for religious books like the Bible and so on. So quite an amazing thing that we have this pretty much complete text of a book written, let's see here, written around 2300 years ago. And these I think some of the dates are a little bit uncertain, but anyway, over 2000 years ago, this book was written. And it actually contained work by generations of previous great mathematicians. And I mentioned Eudoxus. I think he was actually the guy who is credited with sort of discovering a lot of the stuff that's in the Elements. Euclid is believed to have kind of made the proofs more rigorous and tightened up the logic of the whole thing. And here we are today studying this stuff. And you can imagine what people thought when these manuscripts started being discovered in the 1500s and 1600s, that all of a sudden there is this realization that ancient people had a much greater understanding of the complexities of geometry than anybody in that era. So all of that had been lost for over 1,000 years, almost 2,000 years, and came to light and was translated and compiled. So quite an amazing story in itself. I don't know if any of you are interested in scholarship of the ancient world, but I get the feeling that it's still pretty active, and so there's probably some career opportunities there, especially combining mathematics and scholarly studies of the ancient mathematicians. Okay, well, this is sort of a long chat, introduction-wise, and I think we'll stop the history lesson here and the history discussion and come back to the problem of constructing continuous functions between geometric objects. In a way, what we're trying to do here is build up to a understanding of continuous functions and the topological notion of continuous mappings between topological spaces. And I think that's really the most elegant, rigorous formulation of continuity. So we're doing a little bit of conceptual exploring today. I hope you enjoyed this chat, and please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.